Yeah, mama used to be on disability, but gave me this ability, and now she walking with her head high and her back straight. I don't think you feeling me, I'm out here being everything they said I wouldn't be or couldn't be. I don't know what happened to them guys that said they would be. I said, see you at the top and they misunderstood me. I hold no resentment in my heart, that's that maturity, and we don't keep it on us anymore, it's with security. I'm outside, 29, G5.
You made the jump from New York Red Bulls to Chelsea, and then which led you to a life on loan, as Chelsea has come to be infamously known for as a Chelsea fan myself. But what was that like? I mean, you were playing with the men's team at Red Bulls for 2 years, didn't see much time, and then you had one great season, was a big part of that season. And the next season Chelsea comes knocking, and that started your European career.
Yeah, it all happened very quickly. Started playing at Red Bull pretty young. I was able to Jesse Marsh gave me backed me with a lot of confidence and gave me an opportunity, and I kind of took it with both hands. So that was definitely a great moment for me, playing for my hometown club, playing every game, winning the Supporters Shield, and then had a good U20 World Cup. And I remember there was a lot of European offers at the time. Chelsea came in strong in the winter, and then it was kind of, you know, that was the best option for me at the time. It was, I remember speaking with Mourinho when he was the manager. He wanted me with the first team right away. I saw a path at the time because, you know, you had Gary Cahill, JT, and Ivanovic and Zuma right at the time, center backs. So you had three guys that were, you know, getting older, and then you had a younger guy. And I kind of came into the first team picture as another younger guy to see if I can, you know, make a pathway for myself and learn from the older guys. Unfortunately, Mourinho got sacked a few weeks after I met with him. But the club still believed in me and went out for me and got me. So I was able to be with the first team for, you know, that 15-16 season. But then Conte came in the next preseason. The reality was I was a young, raw central defender from America. I had, 50 MLS games at the time. So the reality was, you know, Conte or a big manager like that wasn't going to rely on a young center back with relatively no European experience. So the reality was I had to go on loan, and Vitesse was the perfect option for me, going to Eredivisie for a club fighting for European spots. And I was able to get in and get my games in, win a trophy, and play Europa League. So I got a bunch of experience through there. And then that kind of obviously led me to a few other loans. But at the time, you know, when that all happens, you know, there's more managerial changes at Chelsea. You're playing for one of the biggest clubs in the world. They're going to go out and buy, you know, a $30, $40 million center back and go with him. And, you know, that's why you see a lot of players that go on loan from Chelsea are, you know, previous players from previous managers that get sacked. And a new manager comes in, gets his own players. There's also a lot of young academy players from Chelsea that go on loan because you have the best academy in Europe technically, and then you have like one of the best first teams in the world, and there's a big gap, and they're too good for the academy, the young kids, but they're not good enough for the first team at the time, so they have to go out on loan and get experience, and just that's how it goes. So there's a stigma that, you know, the loan, if you get loaned out, it's not good, but it's actually really good for you and your development. You know, you're going out and playing men's football.
Right.
So a lot of people who have this notion that it's not good, they have no idea what they're talking about. That's part of the development. That's part of the journey for the young player. So.
And coming back into preseason each time with Chelsea, can you explain us your approach there? Because it almost seems like you kind of have to go on trial again, even though you're at this club where you have to prove yourself each time there's new managers each year or whatever it may be. How did you kind of approach this process each preseason?
Yeah, each preseason was a bit different. The reality was after like the first year or two, when I would come back to preseason, I would think like, oh yeah, maybe I have a good chance in preseason to show. But the reality was like, you know, then they buy a wave of new players, and it's hard to break in. That's just the reality. You're trying to break into one of the biggest clubs in the world. So my mindset was kind of trying to get sold at that point. But it's very hard to get sold also, because you have to have three parties to agree to a deal. So sometimes, you know, there were good offers, but they were rejected by the club. Sometimes there were offers, but I wasn't necessarily, you know, interested. So it's like a big process and definitely a lot of things that happened. But definitely after, you know, after I came back from Vitesse, after 2 years, I kind of knew like I needed to kind of get out on a permanent to kind of work my way to get back to that level, if that makes sense. But I was never able to get on a permanent for many different reasons. So, but I was still glad that I was able to get some good loans and good clubs to come in for me and play some solid minutes in different leagues for sure.
Yeah. And how was that first half a season with Chelsea when you first went there to play with the likes of John Terry, Cahill, Ivanovic?
Yeah, it was great, man. It was great. Obviously, it all happened so fast. I was in a high, obviously, you know, I was at 19, 20 years old, just won, you know, a trophy with Red Bulls, playing for my hometown club, just got called up to the national team under Klinsmann. So like, I was like on a real high. And then right away in January, I go to the first team of Chelsea and everything just happened so fast. So it didn't really sink into me when I was there. It was just kind of like just the progression of where I was at. It was a big step and it was kind of, you know, in my mind, I was always envisioning this step. So when I got there, it was great. You know, I was playing with some of the best players in the world at the time, some amazing players, amazing people. It was definitely a great experience. You know, I was on the bench in some Champions League games, made my Premier League debut. So it was definitely definitely some good experiences. Obviously, I learned a lot playing at that level, what it takes to be the best day in and day out. I learned a lot for sure.
Another influential person in your career and someone who's had a star-studded Premier League career of their own was Vincent Kompany at Anderlecht. And I've heard you speak about him a little bit on some other podcasts, and I was just wondering if you could dive into what it's like to play for a manager like him and what you've kind of learned both on and off the field from him.
Yeah, he was amazing. He was one of the best managers I ever had. I can speak a lot about him. I can't say enough good words. I learned a lot from him, not just because he was a center back and he always gave me tips and gave everybody, all the defenders, tips in a lot of certain situations, but the way he approached, you know, his tactics and his philosophy, you can see that, you know, every moment on the pitch that we were doing played a role in how we played as a team. Because a lot, you know, you can easily, like, I've been at a lot of clubs and been with coaches, and most of the coaches are like this. You know, you do sometimes drills and sessions, and they're not really, you know, they're just football drills or a possession drill or, you know, a 5v5, small-sided. But with him, every type of drill, every moment in the session was a way to emphasize our philosophy and build on how we play the game. So that was really helpful. Even on the video, we would do tactical analysis of a pre-match analysis of the opponent, and we would watch the video and then the scout, and he would show, you know, how the other team plays, and then he would draw and show tactics on how we're going to play against them and beat them and show opportunities for us to exploit the opponent. Sorry, I need a glass of water. And then we would go on the pitch and work on it. So he would show it to us on the board and then the video, and then we would work on it in training. And when you worked out in training, we go on the pitch, and exactly what he would say, what would happen is exactly what would happen on the pitch. It was just a matter of us executing the moment and the strategies. And most of the time we were able to do that. Sometimes we weren't, but we're not perfect. So it happens. But that was the first time I've ever been part of a coaching staff where like it was so detail oriented, every situation. And then when game day came about, you were so prepared and you were so ready and so confident. And that's what you really want as a player, to be prepared for game day and have the confidence that, yeah, we're a good team and we know how to play and we're going to stick to our principles. So He was really good at that.
Does it surprise
and
you?
See it now they just got promoted. They just
I was just gonna say, does it surprise you?
I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised. I said when I was at Anderlecht, I said that, you know, he was gonna be a manager for a big club sooner rather than later. So I still believe that. And as you can see, he just took Burnley in his first year in the championship, which is not easy. No. Definitely not easy. And he went to he got promoted with 100 points or something like that. So fair play to them. So the congratulations to the people over there. Yeah.
How have all these moves adapting to all these different places, leagues and countries helped you grow on and off the field?
Yeah, it definitely makes you grow up, obviously, because you got to adapt quickly. You know, there's no time for to settle in, really, because you're there. You got to perform right away. If you don't perform, the next guy comes and takes your position. Or not even that. You're going in there to take the other guy's position because you're on loan, technically. So you got to earn your position. And then you play all the parts. You know, sometimes, you know, you don't have as much, I should say, you don't have as much strikes as the other guy that is from that country and has played at that club for a while to make bad performances or have a bad run of form. You know, so sometimes there's managerial changes. So the two times that I went out on loan, for example, to France and then to Spain, the two managers that brought me in, they ended up getting sacked like midway through the season. And then a new manager comes in and sometimes it doesn't work out. You know, you're not his player, you're on loan. You know, the reality is you have an American cloud over your head, and that kind of plays a part in some managers. So that all those things play a part, and you have to just make sure that you're ready at all times. So I've had some good stints. I've had some, you know, not great stints, but a lot of learning moments from those stints. And it's definitely a sink or swim world in Europe. You know, you don't have the, you know, the realities. Everyone's fighting for their job. It's a, you know, there's promotion, there's relegation. There's certain incentives on finishing in certain positions in the table. So every moment in every game is important, you know. And for example, you know, guys are fighting for contracts. Guys are fighting, you know, to get sold, to show themselves for the next move. So every moment in training, every game is important. And I feel like that lacks a little bit in MLS, because the reality is there's no consequences if you really play bad. You know, for example, as a team, you know, you won't get relegated to the second division. Your paychecks will still be paid on time. Your paychecks, if you get relegated, won't, you know, get a 30%, 40%, 50% deduction. So that sense of urgency, those little details matter with games and intensity of these games and the passion these games show. So those are little details that are, I think, big factors in the way the differences between European football and American football.
When you reflect on your time in Europe, which opportunities, or is there one opportunity that could have, that kind of stands out to you in terms of being your favorite, or where you learned the most, or where you were able to perform your best on the field?
I had a lot of good moments. That's tough to say. I mean, you know, I look at each season and can pick a moment from each season, to be honest with you, because I was at, you know, a different club for a majority of that. I just remember when I was in Holland, winning the Dutch Cup. That was really special and important. That was Vitesse's first year, first trophy in the history of their existence. And I remember playing, it was like, you know, when you watch the TV, like a, you know, a cup final, it was us versus us at Alkmaar. So one, that was 25,000 yellow and black, 25,000 red and white. And Crazy. It was an incredible atmosphere. We ended up winning the game 2-0. That was phenomenal. When I went to Reading, for example, like I came in and we were in a relegation battle, and the intensity and the pressure of those games, of relegation battle games are amazing and definitely like nerve wracking, and then being able to survive and escape relegation that year was really relieving, and it felt really good to come in and help that club avoid relegation and play in those intense games, because that also, you know, builds character and teaches you how to, you know, play under pressure in certain scenarios. So that was also a fun moment, you know, going to Anderlecht and being a leader that season. I remember Vinny's first year, and there was a lot of pressure on the club, Anderlecht being Anderlecht, biggest club in Belgium. So everyone's watching. That was also good. I learned a lot in football terms in Anderlecht. And then probably, you know, last year in Spain was awesome for me and my wife. We loved it. The beginning was great because I was playing like every game. Obviously, then there was a managerial change and I had COVID and I lost my spot and all this stuff happened and I couldn't get it back. But living in Spain was another great experience. I was able to learn a new language, and the lifestyle in Spain was definitely awesome off the pitch. So that was very enjoyable. So every place was enjoyable, that's for sure. And then obviously along that journey, all the people and teammates you meet, you become lifelong friends, and I've made some amazing friends through those times. So I can never take that away from that. You know what I mean?